Okay, and what we're going to do in this class is summarize all these non-optimal equalizers that we've been looking at, and see one example case where we actually derive it for each of those, derive all the equalizers for one simple example case. Okay, so I'm going to summarize first, and my summary is somewhere here. Okay, I can't find it. Okay, summary is somewhere here. So I'll make a table and we'll talk about it. Okay, so here's what we're looking at. Sk and Es is expected value of mod Sk squared. Okay, Hc. Like I said, there's also a version where you have a PSD for Sk. Okay, so I'm assuming the PSD is just flat and Es in this case. Assuming IID SK, there's also a version when this is not, and it's not significantly different from the other case. You simply replace wherever you have ES with the power spectral density, you'll get the same answer. Okay, so it's not very different, but anyway, I've not done that explicitly in this class. So you have NK. We did look at the case where the noise has a certain power spectral density and it's not necessarily white. Okay, but in most cases, we will restrict at least in evaluation. We will restrict ourselves to this thing. Okay, and H of Z, I'm going to assume splits as H0, Hmin, Hmax, and then all this results in a ZK, and our suboptimal equalizer is going to come after ZK. It's going to process ZK to try and estimate SK. Okay, so that's what it's going to do. And SZ, if you see, right, we will need SZ also, right, in the many of the, at least in the MSC criteria, SZ naturally shows up. And that we'll take to be this. Okay, so I apologize for the bad notation here. The subscript and the argument of these functions are the same, but hopefully it's not too bad. Then you can distinguish which is the subscript and which is the argument. Okay, so it's not too bad. Okay, so let's make a table. The table is going to be linear equalizer, zero forcing, then MMSE. And then DFE. Okay, and let me draw some lines. Let's make a line below that. And under linear equalizer, we're going to have two different. So linear equalizer, you have to only worry about one filter, right? Just the D, and then the MSE corresponding to that. Okay, and for so these two, I'll write down, so D is not too bad. Okay, and the MSC is also not too bad. Okay, and for the DFE likewise, you have unlike the linear equalizer, you have two filters that you have to worry about. The first is the precursor, which I have denoted as DW, right? D times W, and this requires some space. Then followed by the post-cursor equalizer, which again requires some space here. So hopefully I'm not running out. And then finally the MSC corresponding to each of those guys. Okay, so it's good to have such a table and try to fill it out. Okay, so if you look at zero forcing linear, 1 by H is D, right? So you put a one filter with 1 by H and then you slice after that. Okay, so what is the MSE? It's also very easy. It's going to work out as the arithmetic mean of SN by mod H squared. Okay, so you can see why it will work out like that. You just filter the filter, the ISI completely goes away, but noise gets filtered by D, right? D, which is 1 by H. So SN is going to get multiplied by 1 by mod H squared. The arithmetic mean of that will be the variance of the noise, and that has to be the MSE. Okay, the MMSE linear equalizer worked out to ES times H star divided by SZ. Am I right? Okay, this is what it worked out to, and in this case, the mean square error works out to SN divided by mod H squared plus SN by ES. The arithmetic mean of this quantity. Okay, So you can compare these two, the MMSE linear equalizer and the zero forcing linear equalizer, and probably conclude that one is less than the other. It's quite easy to conclude because the denominator is increasing by a positive quantity. Certainly in some points it's going to be non-zero, so it's going to pull it down. Okay, so that's the arithmetic mean. So it's this MMSE is better. And in terms of implementation, you'll have to worry about the poles being introduced by 1 by h or by ESH star by SZ. Okay, so then depending on the poles and where they are, they might be implementable, stable, unstable, all kinds of problems might arise. Okay, so that's the DFE. Okay, so you move to the decision feedback case, things are slightly more complicated. You have many more filters, and the zero forcing, the filter happens to be 1 by H0, H max star divided by H max. Okay, which is an all pass filter, which only filters the phase, and then MN inverse, which is the whitening part of that filter. Okay, since it's all pass, noise PSD doesn't change after that, so you can filter with simply MN inverse to make it make the noise white. Okay, so you know in the DFE, the slicer error is expected to be white, right? So you're whitening, so that's something that works out. And then W worked out as a little bit more complicated in this case. Hmin, Hmax star divided by Mn minus 1. Okay, no, there's no minus 1. Is there a minus 1? There's no minus 1, right? So I'll write W minus 1 here just to be consistent. Okay, so that's the precursor, the postcursor filter. It's actually not W, it's W minus 1. Okay, so I'm writing W minus 1. Okay, so in this case, if you compute MSC, what is the assumption you have to make to compute MSC easily? There's no error propagation at the slicer, right? The slicer is making accurate decisions. If the slicer were to make accurate decisions, then the MSC will work out to nicely the what mean? The geometric mean of Sn by mod h square. Okay? So since we know the geometric mean is smaller than the arithmetic mean, when compared to the zero forcing linear equalizer, the MSC in the DFE will be, zero forcing DFE will be better. Okay, slightly less. Okay, but what's the catch there? What's the problem with talking about MSE for this? Okay, for DFE, zero forcing, it's not a big deal, but for the MMSE, we'll see. Okay, the next thing is the MMSE filter. Here, the precursor worked out to gamma z squared. H star, not just H max star, it's H star divided by MZ star, which is not all pass, followed by Mn inverse. Okay, and the postcursor worked out to Mz Mn inverse minus 1. And in this case, the MSE will work out to the geometric mean of this quantity. Okay, so you see, when compared to the MMSE linear equalizer, the MMSE DFE is going to be better, and when compared to the zero forcing DFE, the MMSE DFE is still going to be better. Which is the comparison that you cannot make easily in terms of zero forcing MMSE, you know, DFE and the MMSE linear equalizer. So that's the comparison you can't make directly unless you do accurate computation. You won't know which is the mean square error. Okay, so the MMSE case, the mean square error can be a little bit misleading. Okay, the reason is, since your noise is not purely Gaussian, you have some symbol component, you can't treat it purely as Gaussian, and your probability of error may not necessarily go down just because the mean square error went down. Okay, so later on hopefully in this class or next class, I'll show you a nice way in which you can actually get larger MSE but have better probability of error in the MMSE DFE. Okay, so that's a very interesting idea. Okay, but this is a picture. Okay, so what you have to learn, okay, so this first thing is, while we relax the assumption of MLSD, complexity is probably going down, but still it doesn't mean that all these filters are implementable. Several times we ended up with IIR anticausal filters. Okay, IIR anticausal can only be approximated. Okay, so in that way, these filters are not constrained in complexity. So in most cases, anybody who wants to build a filter will say, I can only do so many taps. Ok, Okay, so many taps, causal, so many taps, anticausal. So it's all finite. You delay it and you implement it. That's the only thing you do. Okay, you can't say I'll implement an IAR anticausal. Okay, so these things don't work very easily. Okay, so that's one thing to keep in mind. So these derivations are just to give you a nice idea about how the. Is there a question at the end? Any question? Okay. So it's just to give you an idea of how the optimal structure will look. What can you expect in the optimal structure? What kind of problems can you expect even in the optimal structure during equalization? What happens in your channel if the zero moves outside the unit circle? Right? You may think zero moving outside the unit circle should not cause any problem to me in the equalizer, but we'll see in one of the calculations that can cause trouble in many of your equalizers. Okay? So you should know where you're paying the penalty. Okay? So those kind of nice intuitive calculations can be done in this framework, even though the filter is slightly suboptimal. Okay, so also this feeds into a lot of ideas that you use in suboptimal constructions. Okay, so what you have to learn, okay, this is very important, learn is given a H of Z and an SN, okay, and a constellation, you should learn how to compute, okay, all rational, okay, I'll not expect you to do it for non-rational cases, all rational cases, you should know how to compute each of these things, okay, and this involves a certain level of DSP skill. Okay, and if you're not sure about your Z transforms, what it means to write Z inverse, things in terms of Z, what is max, what is min, where the zeros comes, where the pole comes, I would strongly suggest you go in and read up a little bit. It's not too late now. You should be able to compute each of these quantities. Okay, and remember, you can avoid computing, you can avoid integrals in all the MSc computations. How do you avoid integrals in the arithmetic mean computation? Arithmetic mean is the coefficient of z power 0. Okay, how do you avoid integrations in the geometric mean computation? You have to do a spectral factorization. Assuming you can do a spectral factorization, you have identified the minimum phase and maximum phase components, you can avoid integration. Why is that? Right, the geometric mean comes out as the constant in the spectral factorization, right? Any spectrum you factorize, it's geometric mean times the minimum phase monic times the maximum phase monic. So you pull out all the coefficients, you will get the spectral factorization very easily. Okay, so maybe I'll show it for some simple examples. I'm sure in the tutorial problems, you'll do more of this. Okay, so this is something that we'll do. Okay, so any questions, anything that disturbed you, any comments you might want to make about any of these things? Okay. So one thing I'm leaving out is the argument. So anytime I write H star, it's H star 1 by Z star in the for the Z transform. Okay, so remember that. That's very important. Okay. All right. So if this is reasonable, then we'll proceed with the examples that we're going to do. Or rather one example. Okay. So here's the example that we're going to do. We'll try to build all these equalizers for that example. Okay, I have to get this thing in order. Okay, so this is my example. I'm going to take H of Z to be 1 plus C Z inverse, and I will let the noise to be simply N naught, which is white. Okay, so it's a simple 1-0 system, and here we'll say C is a complex number. Okay, I will not say it's real or anything else. It's complex, and I will let my transmit constellation to be BPSK plus minus 1. Okay, so those are all my various assumptions. Okay, so we'll start with the zero forcing linear equalizer. Okay, so the zero forcing linear equalizer structure has only one filter, and what will that filter be in this case? 1 by H, which is 1 plus Z inverse. Okay, and what's MSC? Okay, so here again, it's the arithmetic mean of N0 divided by mod h square. So how do you write mod h square? H times h star. Okay, what is h? Which h star you would take? 1 by z star. Okay, so remember that, it's very important. I'm doing arithmetic mean on the unit circle. Okay, so when I do it with the z transform and try to find z, it automatically becomes 1 by z star. Okay, so keep, remember that. So I'm going to write here, I want to find the arithmetic mean of this. Okay, so you should be careful about what this means. I've written z transform, but the arithmetic mean is on the unit circle, but this is useful because now I can write a partial fraction expansion and quickly figure out the coefficient of z power 0. Okay, so something that keep in mind. Okay, so if you do that, okay, I'm not going to do that right now, so you'll have to be careful about several assumptions. Okay, what are the assumptions you would be careful about in the partial fraction expansion? Okay, yeah, so you'll have to make sure that your ROC includes the unit circle, otherwise you have no business computing many of these things. Okay, so you have to include that, so things will expand differently depending on this modulus of z of c. If mod c is less than 1, you will expand it in a certain way. If mod c is greater than 1, you might have to expand it in a different way. Okay, so but eventually you can do all the computation and this will work out to, I think I did this for the other example, so I'm not going to repeat it in this case. The only thing that's different is c star, that won't change anything. So this should work out to something like this. Okay, n naught by, well, I think there's a modulus outside as well. Okay, so check this. So for mod c greater than 1, I think something happens here. I've not really checked it, so I want you to check it for both cases. For mod c less than 1, I'm quite sure this is very correct. For mod c greater than 1, please check this calculation. I think it is correct, but check it. Okay, so this is your mean square error, okay, with the linear equalizer. Okay, so if you look at implement possibilities for implementing this d, mod c less than 1, you can, it is okay in general, okay for everything. Okay, so mean square error is blowing up, but it's okay. Okay, this is not too bad. For mod c greater than 1, it immediately becomes, d becomes non-realizable. Okay, what's the reason? You have a pole outside the unit circle, and if you include it, it's a ROC that includes 0, so it's going to be anticausal. Okay, and it's going to be IAR anticausal, and you can't really realize it. It has to be approximated if at all you want to realize it. Okay, so that's the zero forcing linear equalizer, and this is how it works out. Okay, so the zero forcing DFE is the next thing that we're going to do. Okay, so if you go back and look at the table that you have, in the zero forcing DFE, I have to distinguish between mod c less than 1 and mod c greater than 1, because the structure completely changes whether or not I have mod c less than 1, mod c greater than 1. Okay, because I have to do a minimum phase factorization for h of z. Okay, and if mod c is less than 1, 1 plus z, z inverse shows up in h min. If it is greater than 1, it's going to show up in h max. Okay, so things completely change depending on whether or not mod c is less than 1. This will happen only for the zero forcing DFE. Okay, other things it won't happen. So the zero forcing DFE, you have to pay some attention. Okay, it's not very straightforward. You have to know where the poles and zeros of the channel are before you can determine the zero forcing DFE. Okay, so first case I'll do is mod c less than 1. This is something we did before also, so I'll do that very easily. Okay, so for mod c less than 1, what happens to this channel? H of z is a minimum phase channel, so the same thing that we did before applies. Okay, for the minimum phase channel, the precursor becomes what? Precursor becomes 1. Okay, so there's really no precursor. Okay, and the postcursor becomes 1, simply m of z minus 1, which is c z inverse, right? And what is the mean square error? Same as before? No. Geometric mean is what? Geometric mean will be only n naught. Okay, there's no divided by 1 minus c square, right? Sn by mod h square, if you take geometric mean, the coefficient outside is only n naught. See, h of z is already minimum phase monic. The other part will be maximum phase. The geometric mean works out as only n naught. Do you see that? Okay, so you have to evaluate the geometric mean of what? So let me do that. But I think it's important that I do this carefully. It's the geometric mean of Sn divided by mod h square. So what is that? Sn is simply n naught times h of z, which is 1 plus c inverse, times h star of 1 by z star, which is 1 plus c star z. Okay. So the geometric mean of this is very easy to evaluate because it's already in spectrally factorized form, with both of these guys being monic. Okay, so you can simply read it out, and that comes out as n naught. Okay. So once again, in the previous example we saw also, we expected this, right? You compare the MSE for linear zero forcing linear equalizer and the MSE for zero forcing DFE. DFE is better. Okay, it works out to n naught. Okay, which is larger than n naught by 1 minus mod c squared when mod c is less than 1. Okay, so let's draw this structure. I think it's useful. I'll show you once again how this works out. Make this mistake always. Sk goes through 1 plus c z inverse. Noise gets added. PST, remember, is nothing. Okay, and then you do, there's no pre-filtering. Simply C, Z inverse, and you get your S hat. Okay, and this structure achieves an MSE of N naught, which is very good. Okay. So the second case we'll consider is when mod C becomes greater than 1. Okay, so in this case, you have to worry a lot about what your H min and H max is. Okay, so look at H of Z. Okay, it's 1 plus C Z inverse. Okay, H max you write it usually as in terms of Z, right? You don't write it as in terms of Z inverse. So you'll have to play around with this. This is important and easy, but if you haven't seen before, you'll be surprised at how this thing looks. Okay, so this is how you write h of z in h0, h min, h max format. Okay, so once you write it like this, things can be very easily figured out. Okay, so this becomes your h naught. Okay, this is a delay which you can ignore, right? C z inverse. You remember in my general h of z formulation, I had a h0 times z power r, and I said any z power r we will ignore, times a part which is written in a way similar to the h min. Okay, so you should remember h min, and then the h max. Okay, so this will be my h max. Okay, so watch out for this. It's a subtle change, but if you're not used to it, it will be confusing. Okay, so that's how you identify the h max and the h min. Okay, so you pull out. And it's useful to write it in monic form. Okay, so I want to write it in monic form also, because then further spectral factorizations become easy and obvious. Okay, you can just pull it out, because we assume that when we did the derivations for those structures. Okay, so once you do this, the precursor becomes what? You go through and apply the formula. It's 1 by h naught h max star by h max times mn inverse, right? Mn inverse is 1. And h naught is c, so you have 1 by c times h max star by h max. What is h max star? 1 plus 1 by c star z inverse divided by 1 plus 1 by c c. This is my h max. Okay, what type of filter is it? It's IIR anti-cos. Okay, so its pole, where is the pole? At minus c, which will be outside the unit circle. Okay, so this is IIR anticausal and definitely not very implementable. Maybe you can approximate it in practice. Okay, so what's postcursor? This is, if you go through the postcursor, what is the formula? It will work out as 1 by c z inverse. Okay. And this is okay. One can implement the postcursor without any problem. 1 by C, Z inverse. Okay. And what about MSC? It's going to be the geometric mean of what? Sn by mod h squared. Okay, remember now the mod h squared, the minimum phase, maximum phase and all be different, but you have a h naught also, so you have to be very careful about that. So Sn is simply n naught. Mod h square will give you a mod c square times what? H max star. Okay, so which will be the minimum phase part and which will be the maximum phase part? H max star will be the minimum phase monic part and H max becomes the corresponding maximum phase part. From here you can quickly read out the geometric mean to be n naught by mod c square. Okay. Alright. So I want to make an important point. Remember, for this structure MSC was n naught. Okay. For mod c greater than 1, can I cancel ISI with the structure here on top with the same structure as before for mod c less than 1? If all I want is to cancel ISI, right? Look at the structure, it will work, right? You go through the filter and look at what it does. At the input to the slicer, you won't have any ISI. You'll only have noise. So even if mod c is greater than 1, I can do this. Nothing stops me from doing this. Assuming my S hat of k is accurate, I'll definitely get S of k minus 1, c times S of k minus 1, and that is the signal component coming here. It will definitely cancel, right? You just write the equations, you'll see it cancels. Okay? But look at the filter that we've got for mod c greater than 1. Okay? So what's the advantage in doing all this filtering, and which is different from the precursor we had before, right? This filtering is much more complicated than the precursor for mod c less than 1. So what's the point in doing all this filtering for mod c greater than 1? If we only want to cancel ISI, it looks like ISI is getting cancelled there also. So what's the point? It's a very simple answer. It's right there on the same slide. So why did we want to put down such? Sorry. Yeah, it's a bad thing, right? So I know. I mean, why do you want to do all this crazy anti-causal filtering when you can cancel ISI with simply no precursors? What's the point in doing all this? The mean square error is going down. Okay, so if mod c is greater than 1, n0 by mod c square is definitely less than n0. If you are okay with an MSC of n0, then you might as well cancel an ISI with that. Okay, if you are not okay with an MSC of n0, you want a much lower mean square error, you have to go through all this pain. Okay, and in this configuration, this is the minimum mean square error possible in the zero forcing idea. Okay, if you want to force the SI to zero, you will have to pay this penalty. Okay, so all these things are important signal processing ideas at the receiver. I mean, you might want to think about all these things. If you really want the MSC to go below N0, then you have to do this. Okay, that's one point. The other point is, when mod C greater than 1, look at what's happening to ZK. Okay, what is ZK? So let me make a few remarks. Okay, when mod c greater than 1 results in a more complicated precursor for lower MSC. Okay, but you can as well use the same filter as before, right? So c is just a general value. If it's one, in one case it got cancelled, other case also it will get cancelled. Doesn't matter what mod c was. But if you are willing to pay that penalty for higher MSC, then you can stick with the same old thing as before. It might be interesting to look at. Okay, so that's the first remark. The other remark is, look at zk. Zk is what? Sk plus c sk minus 1 plus nk, right? Okay, look at what's happening. You typically expect mod c to be less than 1, right? See, the corresponding, so you have to adjust your delays in the receiver so that sk has maximum strength in zk. Okay, if it doesn't have maximum strength in zk, so maybe you have to adjust it, but in many cases that may not be possible. Okay, so if you imagine a mobile wireless situation, maybe the guy is coming closer to the transmitter, or there are reflections in all kinds of crazy ways. Okay, so you might actually have that in your design equalizer at some point. The second tap is stronger. Okay, so that's the point of maximum phase, right? What's minimum phase versus maximum phase? Maximum phase means the later taps are stronger, the earlier taps are not strong, right? So if you're moving towards a maximum phase type thing, then you actually have to give more weightage to the second tap as opposed to the first tap, which is what the later receiver is doing, this IIR anticausal thing is doing. Okay, the previous filter, in the MOTSI less than one case, your first tap is the strong one, so you throw away the second tap and decide based on the first tap. Okay, so in the second case, you'll have to do much more complicated stuff to get to the minimum mean square error. Okay, so all these things are intuitive things to look at. Okay, so in general, one comment you can make is, if your C is moving towards the origin, okay, then your zero forcing linear equalizer will go for a toss. You don't even have to think about it. But as it crosses the unit circle, okay, so suppose mod C is crossing the, C is crossing the unit circle. So let me just say that. Okay, that's what I want to say. Okay, C is crossing unit circle. Okay, so from minimum phase to maximum phase, your equalizer changes, your MMSE equalizer changes drastically. If you want to hold on to the minimum mean square error, okay, it's going to change completely in a drastic fashion. Okay, so if you don't pay attention to this, you will be doing something which is quite detrimental to your receiver. There will be huge error propagation, it will go all over the place. Okay, so some things to pay attention to. So this kind of intuition you can't build if you do only practical things, right? So you need to do the ideal case first to understand the intuition behind what the problem is with zeros in the channel. The zero is inside the unit circle, what's the problem? If it's on the unit circle, what's the problem? If it goes outside the unit circle, what are the various problems to equalize? Okay, so that's the kind of thing you can expect. Okay, any other questions or comments? Something that's disturbing you about the way this thing is working on? Okay, all right, so that's the zero forcing criteria. So let's move on towards the MMSE criteria. What are the various things I've done so far? I've done only zero forcing linear and zero forcing TFE, right? Yeah, to move towards the MMSE criteria. Okay, so the next thing we'll see is MMSE linear equalizer. Okay, so here you don't have to worry so much about minimum phase, maximum phase, because you don't have to split H. Okay, the filter will be the same irrespective of what the split is. Okay, so that's a nice thing. So there's only one filter here, and that filter has a very ready-made standard formula. It is what? ES times H star divided by ES mod H square plus SN. Okay, ES is 1 for you, right? This is just BPSK, we'll assume equally likely. So ES is 1, there's no problem. What is H star? 1 plus C star Z, okay, divided by mod H squared, which will work out to 1 plus C star Z times 1 plus C Z inverse, okay, plus SN, which is N naught. Is it okay? So that's the formula for D. Okay, so how do you compute, so how do you proceed with any further computation here? Okay, so it's a little bit tricky. You have to factor the denominator. If at all you want to say anything about stability or analysis and you want to do mean square error, first thing you have to do is factor the denominator. How will it factor? Let me see. Denominator is actually has to be it's real and non-negative on the unit circle, right? Denominator. So if you have z as a root, then 1 by z star will also be a root. Okay, so that's a useful trick you can use to factor the denominator. Okay, so in fact, I'll assume that the denominator factors as, what am I going to assume? Okay, so let me write it, because this thing is going to show up in several places. So let me write the denominator separately. The denominator is this SZ, right? Right, this thing is 1 plus C star Z times 1 plus C Z inverse plus N naught. Okay, so I'm going to assume this is factoring as, okay, Okay, so the two roots I'll assume are 1 minus alpha z inverse times 1 minus alpha star z. Can I do this? Okay, so I'll assume this thing is factoring as 1 minus alpha z inverse times 1 minus alpha star z. Okay, so I'll assume also without any problem that mod alpha is less than 1. It's the root inside the unit circle. Okay, so maybe less than or equal to 1 if you insist on allowing for roots on the unit circle. Okay, so what should I put out here to make sure that the constant term agrees? Oh, be very careful. What is the constant term on the left hand side? N naught plus 1 plus mod c square. Okay, so it's a bit of a complicated expression. And is that enough? What's the constant term in the product here? Is it just 1? 1 plus mod alpha square, right? So in the you have to divide by 1 plus mod alpha square. Am I right? Okay, so why did I go to all these pains? Why did I do this? Because I want to do a speckle factorization on the SC, right? So I'm pulling out the constant term. So you see the way I pulled out the constant term to make the minimum phase monic part and the maximum phase monic part. Okay, so it's a simple algebraic thing. There's nothing here, but you should be used to it. If you're not used to it, this thing will come out as a big surprise to you. Okay, so what's the geometric mean of SZ, for instance? It's that constant outside. Okay, so those things we'll use later. Okay. Is it okay? All right. So what's the this filter? Okay. So if you look at the filter D now, okay, it's got two poles, one pole at alpha and the other at 1 by alpha star. Okay, so there's no way it's going to be implementable. Okay, so that's a bit of a problem with having nice real non-negative denominators. Okay, so you're going to have whatever zeros you have, it's going to be reflected on the other side, and you'll have several such other zeros and it will kill you. Okay, so you can't very easily do a implementation. Okay, so these poles will definitely kill you, and implementing D is going to be tough. Okay, so while it's ideal and nice, it's definitely not implementable. It's two-sided and it's going to go for a toss. Okay, and you can only approximate. Okay, so that's the first lesson to keep in mind. But supposing you implement this D, what is your mean square error? Okay, how do you compute that? It's the geometric mean of N naught by this SC, right? N naught by SZ. Can I quickly find the geometric mean of that? I've already done most of the work. Speckle factorization was the important work. So once I do the speckle factorization, it will work out to the MMSE, right? So anytime you do MMSE, the geometric mean will come in. Am I right? Or is it arithmetic mean? Oh, you have to do arithmetic mean. Oh, so this is the, yeah, you're right. Okay, so you'll have to do arithmetic mean of this guy, okay? So the arithmetic mean, you need to do, I thought I did that somewhere, but maybe I've not done this. Wait, let me see. Yeah, so the arithmetic mean is a little bit more tricky. So how do you do arithmetic mean? You have to do partial fraction expansion. Okay, so you do partial fraction expansion, it will work out. You can see what it will work out to. 1 by this will work out to 1 by 1 minus mod alpha square, right? Roughly it will work out to that. Okay, so you can see that. So what's the moral of the story? Make sure you know what the coefficient of z naught will be for 1 by 1 minus alpha z inverse into 1 minus alpha star z, and use that as a ready-made formula. If you're deriving it in the quiz, you're not going to succeed. Okay, I believe the answer is 1 by 1 minus mod alpha square. Okay, so you probably check it out. Okay, so I'm going to ask that you check it out. So I think I have an answer here, but I want you to check this and let me know if this is correct or wrong. The answer that I've got is 1 plus mod c square plus n naught 1 plus mod alpha square divided by 1 minus mod alpha square. Okay, so this is the answer I have, but please check this as the coefficient of z naught in this expression. Okay, so n naught by sc. Okay, check this. Don't be don't just take this as the right answer. I believe this is the answer I have. Okay? It should be right. I mean, it should be easy to check. Alright, so the next thing is the MMSE DFE. Okay, here is where you will get the least error possible, and that will be that will be what? Okay, what will be the precursor? It will work out to 1 by gamma z square times h star by mz star. Okay, we've already done the work, right? Mz star and gamma z square we've already found. Okay, it's the same as the spectral factorization that we did before, and that will work out to, okay, so I've written it here. Okay, h star is 1 plus c star z, and mz star is 1 minus alpha star z. Okay, all right, is that okay? See, this is the same as SZ, right? I have to do a spectral factorization on SZ and then use that. Am I right? Same thing works out here as well. Okay. So that is my precursor. What's my postcursor? Simply MZ minus 1, which will be? MZ minus 1 will be minus alpha Z inverse. Okay. That's the postcursor. Equalizer. Okay, and the mean square error now will be the geometric mean of the previous quantity, and that's easy to read out, and that will work out as n naught times 1 plus mod alpha squared by 1 plus mod c squared plus n naught. And you see easily that this will be the least possible MSE in all the four of all the four MSEs. This will be the least possibility for every case. Okay, of course, for mod c less than 1, there's something else, but everything else it will work out as same quantity. Okay, so look at that very carefully. Make sure you agree that this you can check all those computations. Okay, so once again, this DW, this precursor, will be difficult to implement. Okay, it's going to be IIR anti-causal. But you notice one observation you can make is what? Will it have any causal part? Okay, so this filter is going to be anti-causal, right? Am I right or wrong? Okay, so this filter is anti-causal. So most people who implement MMSE DFE in practice assume the precursor to be anti-causal. You always take an anti-causal precursor. Okay, you don't take both-sided precursors when you do DFE. Okay, the postcursor will be purely causal, purely strictly causal, as in it won't have a zero term also. It will be strictly causal, and the precursor will be taken to be anti-causal for this reason. Okay, so maybe it's not valid in the very general case, but in most cases, an anti-causal filter will handsomely work as your just a precursor. Okay, so the only case to worry about is when there's an MN inverse, right? When there's an MN inverse, that might be a causal part. Okay, so if your noise is white, you don't have to worry about it. It will definitely be anti-causal always. Okay, so that's why it's taken as anti-causal. Okay, so any other comment I wanted to make? Any other questions that you have? Okay, hope it's okay. So in your tutorial, I'll definitely give you problems like this where you have to repeat the same calculation for a different h of z, and maybe with some power spectral density for noise. And it's also a very useful question in the quizzes and finals, right? So make sure you know this by heart. It's just at one level, it's just formula substitution, but at another level, there's some careful DSP that might be involved. Okay, so you should know how to do the factorization very quickly, otherwise you'll be spending a lot of time on useless long calculations which might take you nowhere. Okay, so we have about 5 minutes left, but I think this is a good point to stop, and I'll pick up from here and point out the other thing as we go along. Okay, so maybe I should spend some time talking about the rough roadmap as we go along from here. Okay, so the next thing we'll see is what is generally called constrained complexity equalizers. So here we'll say the my equalizer filter has so many taps. So what's the best equalizer can I have? Okay, so that's the next thing we'll do. Okay. So another thing we have already always done so far is assume that the receiver knows H of Z. Okay, all the receiver processing is based on the knowledge of H of Z. So first we'll assume that the receiver knows H of Z and do the constraint complexity equalizers. After that, finally we'll relax that assumption. Okay. So we'll relax that assumption through training the receiver. Okay. And by building adaptive receivers, adaptive equalizers. Equalizers that can adapt to different channels. So this is very, very useful. That's the next thing we'll see. Okay. So this is very, very practical. So in case in the lab, for instance, people are looking to implement receivers, you'll be implementing adaptive constraint complexity receivers. Okay. So equalizers, that's what you'll be implementing. That's the only thing you can implement. Okay. So that's the next thing we'll see. So after this, we will see more elaborate and complete practical receivers. So more practical receivers. Receiver structures, as in, so far two assumptions we have always made is the carrier is exactly known, carrier phase is exactly known, carrier frequency is exactly known, and then we have also assumed that the timing is exactly known. Okay, so we'll relax those two assumptions and generally see a receiver structure which is fairly large. Okay, so between these two we may or may not see one more thing. I have not decided if I should do it, which is what's called, I think it's called several things, it's called fractionally spaced equalizers. Okay. Okay, so in most cases we have so far assumed only symbol rate sampling, right? We always assume H of Z is a symbol rate model. There's nothing that we have changed so far about symbol rate sampling. Okay, we always did symbol rate sampling. But it turns out the precursor equalizer is a major problem to implement its symbol rate sampling. The ideal precursor equalizer seems to be unimplementable. Okay, so several people actually in practice do twice the symbol rate sampling just for the precursor. After that you do just symbol rate, but just for the precursor you do twice the symbol rate just to get better implementations and better theory. There's also theory behind it which suggests that's better. Okay, so we may or may not do it. I might just quickly refer to it, then we'll move on to the next structures. Okay, so after that, depending on time, we'll do the remainder.